Our next question was sent in via email to cornydrivethrough@gmail.com. It is from Mike Mills from the Booking the Territory podcast, who also has a Smoky Mountain Wrestling review podcast that he does. Hello,
and
Jim.
And who gets retweeted by me on a regular basis?
On the March 13th, 1993 episode of Smoky Mountain Wrestling, Robert Fuller cut a promo where he says he's got women problems and the IRS on his rear end. And he finishes complaining about his problems. He puts his finger to his head as if he's going to blow his brains out and then says, I'm not going to do the Von Erich thing. Doc and I from BTT have a couple questions. One, assuming you did not know Robert Fuller was about to say that,
that would be a good assumption.
What was your initial reaction when you heard it? And two, do you remember there being any blowback from anyone in the wrestling business at the time from Fuller insinuating he wasn't going to commit suicide like a Von Erich?
Well, no, because the only people in the wrestling business that saw it were the people working for Smoky Mountain Wrestling, and they knew Robert. See, that was the thing. The one good thing about Robert Fuller is you didn't need to give him a promo. He could cut a promo at any time, any way, any shape, any form, anywhere on anybody. And as I recall from that promo, I said, okay, you guys go to the desk or whatever. And whether they were talking about the rock and roll or talking about the three team thing we were doing with the bodies or whatever, he had 2 minutes and I said, talk about the fucking what we're doing. I can't even remember what it was. Maybe that might have been coming up on the Knoxville shows or the first Bluegrass Brawl or whatever. The rest of it was from the mind of Robert Fuller. And you know, I didn't wish the Von Erichs any ill will. I don't know if there was any heat because Robert was part of the USWA when they had that Dallas thing going or whatever. I don't know, but it was goddamn, that was promos in those days. Shit got said. What can I say? But I didn't know about it. I didn't know what anybody was going to say beforehand. I knew what they were going to talk about. I didn't exactly know what they were going to say because we didn't do that back then.
Did anyone ever cross the line and say something where you said, okay, we have to redo that or we have to retake that? I mean, I can't even think of a time New Jack did where you had to redo anything.
No, and see, that's the thing. I guess we could have redone it if they'd have gone out and just said fuckity fuckity McFuck fuck or something really phony looking had happened. I had a, anytime you see a crowd shot on Smoky Mountain Wrestling, something looked phony in the ring. That's pretty much a given because that's why I had him shoot crowd shots because we were on limited budget, limited turnaround schedule and limited post-production abilities back in those days. So I couldn't, you know, if something was bad and we could bleep shit, if they cussed accidentally, but if somebody had just gone out and just fucked the whole goddamn thing up, I guess we could have rolled back, but then we would have been smartening up the people in the building if we started something off exactly the same again. So, but we never had to. No, New Jack knew he was on television. I told him go out and make white people mad, right? And I said, but obviously, don't say anything and get us kicked off fucking television. A couple times it might have been close, not as far as profanity, but content possibly. But fortunately, most people that would be offended by the wrestling program weren't watching the wrestling program. The only thing we had to redo that I can think of in Smoky Mountain television history was Al Snow's debut match. I've told that story. You remember that, right?
Yeah.
So I guess you don't want me to tell it again.
No, tell it again. Other people
no, you say, yeah. That's a shitty story. No, basically. And we had to figure out a way to do this because it was in front of a big live crowd. Right. So Al had come down and I've been telling everybody, hey, this guy's great. We're going to have the world's greatest wrestler, Al Snow. And he's going to do all this great stuff. And I get George South to work with him in his first match on Smoky Mountain TV, just so they can have a wonderful high spot match. And Al has been working for quite a while, but has almost never done television since like the ICW days in the 80s, early 80s. So the people are it's a good crowd. I can't remember where we were. I think it was over in Hickory or Morganton, North Carolina. And the place is full and people are easy. And they go to lock up when the bell rings and Al goes one side and yells at the people and then goes to lock up, but goes the other side. And okay, he's working the people a little bit, but the clock is ticking. They got 6 minutes and Al doesn't realize he didn't have his internal clock yet for television. And he thinks because they're getting this great reaction that he should just continue to browbeat the people. Well, by the time that he finished browbeating these people and started actually working, 4.5 minutes of the 6 minutes had fucking gone by, and they get a cue to go home. So he did almost nothing. And then basically fucking beats George South, the goddamn whatever his finish was. So, and that looked good. So he comes back, and I'm in the locker room throwing chairs in the corner. Bam, bam, bam. He's going to ask, how was it? He can see how it was. Here comes George. I said, here's what we're going to do. George, you go back out there and you say, there's no way that that man can beat me again. He caught me unawares, and challenge him to get back in the ring. Al, you go back and get in the fucking ring, and goddamn, y'all do some high spots, do some wrestling, right? Some action. And then we'll put that in and then use your previous entrance and the previous finish. And they go back out there and they do that. And as soon as they lock up, they go into the goddamnest spot where they're hitting the ropes and dropping down and hip tossing and drop kicking and doing all this stuff for about 35 or 40 seconds nonstop. And I'm like, yeah, this is going to be good. And then boom. And then a small package. And 1, 2, 3. I'm like, what the fuck? They did one spot. So if you go back and you watch Al Snow's debut on Smoky Mountain Wrestling television, it's parts of two matches and it ain't that long.
Did Bob Caudle ever say anything to you about the gangsters interviews? Because he looks so uncomfortable standing next to New Jack.
Well, wouldn't you be?
Well,
fuck. Bob has probably got his hand on his wallet every fucking second, and possibly with good reason. No, he never. I mean, you know, Bob was Bob was fun. B, Bob was smart to the business. C, Bob was no longer working for Jesse Helms. To where some political opponent in North Carolina could say, well, look what your employee is doing here on television with this Negro American fellow. So no, he didn't say anything. The only thing he ever said was, boy, those trips were starting to get harder when he had to go across that mountain up into fucking Western Virginia or somewhere from Raleigh.
That dividing line was where Steve Skyfire turned into Steve Skydiver, I believe. But anyway, our next question here, Jim, sent in to cornydrivethrough@gmail.com is from Brad Murr. Jim, what are your thoughts on today's Impact? How do you feel on talent like, you're going to have to excuse me, I don't know a lot of these people, Ali, Lax, Sue Young, and the return of the X Division?
Well, Lax is LAX, Latin American Exchange.
Oh, excuse me. I thought that was another person.
It used to be Homicide and Hernandez, and now it's two younger folks that have taken on the mantle. You know, I actually probably would have given them a compliment if this had been taped even a day previously to this, but Impact Wrestling could go fuck themselves with a rusty fucking fishing knife.
Whoa. Has something happened I don't know about?
Apparently they're doing these, and you know, and Don Callis, I love you, I'm sorry, but unless you fire everybody that had anything to do with this, or Ed Nordholm, if you want to fucking step in and see whose head you can lop off over this, but apparently they're doing these Twitch specials now, and apparently they're doing them in conjunction with local independent promotions, which is a great idea. And actually another one that I had with Ring of Honor a while back to work with the legitimate local promotions in each area that we ran live events in. But nevertheless, I digress. They're doing these and they were in somewhere in Ohio, I now understand, for Ohio versus everything, or Ohio hates everything, or Ohio fucks everything up, or whatever the fuck, which is one of the tag teams. And it's a theme that they were using or what, I don't know. But I saw this on Twitter. It was on, at first I thought somebody was ribbing that they'd superimposed an Impact Wrestling logo to make Impact look bad or knock them or whatever. And I thought, well, that's kind of bullshit that you'd fake something, right? That you'd put a recognized company's logo on a piece of shit fucking outlaw match in a barn, right? Come to find out it was on the special that Impact put their name and branding on, where this completely grotesque, unprofessional, fat fuck comedy wrestler, a wrestler in quotation marks, and some other fucking fat outlaw guy wearing his uncle's pajamas, I don't know, and they're in this dark fucking barn And I assume there were people there past the front row of two sides. You didn't see them much, but whatever the fuck. They didn't have enough of a budget to pipe in some noise. There were some people yelling from the corners. The fat fuck and the other just regular fuck go to do a spot where the regular fuck's dropping down and the fat fuck's jumping over him, right? But the guy drops down and the fat fuck stops and lumbers, because he really can't. He's such a fucking corpulent, obese piece of shit, such a human fucking waterbed, that he can't really get his leg up, but he steps over kind of slowly and again. And then they're just doing slow motion bullshit comedy rest. And then another time the guy goes out on the floor and the fat guy goes like he's going to fucking dive. But of course he can't dive because he looks like one of the McGuire twins. He couldn't get through the ropes. So instead he gets out on the apron and then lumbers down and they do more fake wrestling. And since Impact Wrestling decided to put their fucking name on that, then they own it and they're responsible for it. So from me, fuck you. Fuck, unless Don Callis or Ed Nordholm or whoever the fuck else is in charge of that goddamn shit show. I tweeted out, this is why their company that once was the only pretender and only competitor to Vince McMahon, thanks to bad creative and bad leadership. And for years in the Spike era, we know who those places were. Thanks to bad creative and bad leadership and letting the fucking guys do a lot of shit they shouldn't have done in the fucking ring. Now they are reduced to on Twitch broadcasting fucking programs from a barn in Ohio with an unprofessional fat fuck doing spots to make Haystacks Calhoun look like Tiger Mask. And they wonder why I tweeted that your company has the stench of grisly death on it. So fuck that whole goddamn thing. Because they might as well just fold the goddamn tent, and the Canadians might as well just admit they got fucking snookered and just goddamn set fire to whatever they're doing. Because if that's the best they can fucking do, or if they validate that fucking shit in any way with their logo on a broadcast that they're responsible for, they can suck my big fat white fucking dick. Fuck you.
Our next.
So if you'd asked that yesterday, I'd have said, well, you know, they're trying and, you know, and they've got some good guys there and some friends of mine or, you know, employees there or whatever. But now, no, after I saw that, fuck you. Just get out of the fucking way at this point. Just let guys go somewhere where they can be fucking stars instead of goddamn subjecting the few remaining legitimate talents that you have left to this fucking horseshit and being associated with that to where they get the stench of goddamn play wrestlers and grisly death on them too. I don't know why the fucking guys would even goddamn contemplate going to, why would you want to be involved with Impact Wrestling if that's the kind of shit they're putting out or validating as a talent? Why would you want to be there? Why would you want to be not, especially not contractually obligated, when somebody legitimate might want to give you a fucking job, but just why would you want to validate something like that with your fucking presence if you're a real talent? Fuck. If they can't do any better than that, fucking quit.